talk to you for off and on for the next couple of days about microarrays and how we analyze microarray data. And let me start off by giving one just general comment. A couple of people before we started asked if I recommend things like RStudio or so forth. In general, actually, I don't. I think that that hides you from the actual complexity of the code that you're working with, and RStudio itself has a lot of bugs and problems with it. And I suggest people work directly with the R interpreter. That gives you the best control over your data, the best understanding of what's actually going on, and gives you the best quality analysis. And we'll deal with that over the course of the next couple of days. While you're working on the assignment, I will actually be doing the same thing in front of you, right up on the screen, and give you a chance to see exactly how I would do it. Programming, you get to see how somebody who might be a more experienced developer will do solve the exact same problem. So, in the morning, the first thing that we'll do is start off with a background on microarrays. Most of the time when I refer to a probe or a target, we all mean the exact same thing. We'll also talk about the basic pipeline which microarrays analyze, how we decide what type of algorithm should be applied at what stage. And of course, I'm talking mostly about asymmetric arrays, but I'm actually going to spend today mostly focusing on general features, this morning focusing on general features that are common to any microarray platform. Specialized material as well. If anybody has questions as we go on, just raise your hand at any point in time. I'll also give a couple of kind of designated, okay, what questions do you guys have time? Alright, these are the kind of key things that I'd like you to get out of the course of the module, especially this morning. Start off with a question. The most common type of microarray, the most common type of ohmic experiment is an expression microarray. Standard asymmetrics U133 arrays are the most widely sold microarrays. So, what are they measuring? That's a question for you guys. They measure the number of cycles. Does anybody want to extend on that?
Yeah.
Name tag? That's okay. Gotcha. It was the amount of transcript of RNA and the number of signals. Jenny? Fluorescent signal? Good. Anything else? Fluorescent signal of what? What are they actually measuring? Fluorescent signal of, sorry, CDNA. Does anybody want to expand on that? Fluorescent signal of CDNA. I think we came all the way around to the truth about this. We started off saying it's really only measuring a count. It doesn't measure the absolute amount of an mRNA. In fact, it doesn't even measure the amount of any particular mRNA. It just measures a sequence, and anything that has that sequence will be measured. So in some sense, the technology is fundamentally sequence-focused and gives you a count that we hope is proportional to the amount of mRNA within a certain range, but is not absolutely bounded with it. So keep that in mind as we go through. We're always dealing with something that is proportional to the true signal. You never know there are 13 molecules of RNA in a given sample without developing a titration curve or something like that. I'll start off by talking about what are microarrays, what is exactly the technology, how is it constructed, what makes it the way it does, how are different techniques used to actually measure abundance of something. We'll talk a little bit about applications, but I think this is where you guys are probably familiar. And then we'll talk about the basic overview of how microarray data is analyzed. Now we have the platform to start actually working with it. The classic definition is a definition that is not precisely right. That was the usually use microarrays as a hypothesis generator. And it's for the next couple of slides, and then we'll wrap it up. So, surprisingly, when microarrays were invented,
higher rate of
And you do so using what's called a photolithographic mask. Looks like that. And basically what it does is allows you to shine light through the mask so that only certain regions of the chip are illuminated. Not all of the chip. So you can imagine the linear molecules in this square here activated. So here will be activated. What I mean is, if a beam of light or a photon of light is coming in an unusual angle, then it might not go exactly onto the incident spot that you want it to. Instead of going straight, it'll come through this hole in the mask and it'll fly. This array, what do you guys actually see? I'll quickly walk you through it. This is the 1.2 by 1.2 something like the formula in a little bit as well. So one last thing that I'll point out about affymetric arrays is that the arrays include redundancy, and I said that a few other times. They produce a large series of output files, and that large series of output files includes something that will allow you to change your identification of So
Appomattox arrays are the most widely used. The other important technology used there are the Illumina self-assembling gate arrays. Basically, they create circular gates out of silicon, which are gates that attach to the something like 100,000 one technology. Very similar to how much it's having high quality bottom. I don't have to worry about the quality. $100. Clinical application. Not something that is kind of not something that you might find very useful for our research purpose, but that's not robust enough. By contrast, inspection required. And so eventually sequencing will probably find it ready to replace most microreactors. So for I think it's going to be the longest. Actually, through a microarray, the quality control. discuss the people application of DNA arrays, which is what I talk about
anybody who's still having challenges with their R, we'll pick it up in the next practical. I want you guys to focus on the didactic, and I don't want to kind of delay everybody just to pick up a couple of people. what you're dealing with are probably small issues that we can fix in the next practicum in a couple minutes. All right? So can we have laptops down for people and no side conversations, please? So I want to go through a couple of quick points. There was a question just now about MAS-5 versus other pre-processing techniques, and let's revisit why we do what we just did. I taught you the commands.
You should probably, with a bit of be able to recapitulate that on any data set, but that's not really the challenge. Right. So, why do we do that's the fundamental reason. So to make sure, does anybody want to statistical power? Pretty good. Noise. Technical noise. Good. So I think we basically come at it. In the study. After a few rings, samples are processed, they have the size, array processing, sequence effects due to the sample identity. For example, they have that's affecting the sequence of the processing is to remove systematic technical artifacts. Processing all the substitutes but there's a few basic things that I want you to remember about how to do that correctly. If you can do 8 arrays, but also,
of the design.
benefit of partners that you can now reach. Historically, there are a couple of different techniques that we're going to use. One is called the microarray analysis. Take a long story short, half of that is a technique called the community for the wife and father and mother. Others are very
So we've talked so far about what it is a microarray actually is and how they work. Now we're going to switch to talking about how you analyze them, which will be the focus of the rest of our time. Are there any questions so far? Anything that came up over the break that you go, oh, I didn't quite follow that, or I wanted more information on something?
Right, good question. So we'll address this in a lot of detail over the course of the workshop, but how often is a corporate decision and companies may change their mind on it? So for example, the classic microarray that Appalachian uses is the UN33 plus, the most widely sold array in the world. So how many people have heard of UN33 before? So of you,
who knows what UN33 stands for? UN33 stands for Unigene Build 133. Unigene is an NCBI database that you can access at NCBI just by going NCBI blah 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 / Unigene. And it basically takes our best guess at how transcripts in the genome are defined. And if you take a look at Unigene and click on the statistics for Homo sapiens, great. You can see that our current build is Unigene build 236. Affymetrix U133 is based on Unigene build 133. So given that they're doing it a little bit less than every month, 10 times a year, that tells you that it was based on a definition of the human transcriptome from about 10 years ago. So what changed in 10 years in understanding of the human genome? Well, most of the genome was sequenced back then, but its actual structure and order was pointed out. And on top of that, our understanding of what genes and splice variants look like has changed. And so one of the major things that gets adjusted in any given redefinition of an array is what comprises a gene, what are the different splice variants or isoforms that are being looked at. And if you take a look at it, every new build of Unigene, even today, will lead to taking genes that we thought was a gene, but actually turned out to be a computational artifact of the gene finding programs, and instead two genes that we thought were separate genes actually are the same thing, or alternatively adding new genes that we didn't know exist. So those are the kind of things that will be added as differences. In terms of the rate at which genes are released, as I say, that's a corporate decision. Originally, Affymetrix produced the best-selling array ever, and it made so much money that even when they introduced new arrays, people were willing to pay more for U133 old arrays because they thought that they were so good for comparison and were so comfortable with the technology. So Affymetrix produced these exon arrays, which are actually pretty good, but nobody bought. Very few publications you can find on them. And so they basically didn't produce a lot of arrays. More recently, they've generated an increased number of arrays, gene 2.0 and 3.0, which include non-coding RNAs, links, and then transcriptome 1.0 and 2.0, which are very broad junction, splice junction, and transcript arrays that are very, very good product. But you can kind of see flows in there on how often things are generated. In an ideal world, you'd want a new array platform every time we have a new array of what genes are. And obviously, that's one of the limitations of microarrays is that you can't do that. Any follow-ups or any other questions? Yeah. So that's a tough question to answer. So let me start off here. So the U133 array is probably the most painful array in the world because the original array was called U133, and it had two parts, A and B. And Affymetrix merged them together, which they decided to call the U133+2, and then they decided to make a low-input version of the U133A array, which they called U133A2.0. So the arrays that are in existence are U133A, U133B, U133+2, and U133A2.0. I can only say that I've routinely seen people not use the array that they wanted to because the names are confusing. So that's one thing. Second thing, how easy is it to do that? It depends on how you do your analysis. There are ways to do the analysis, which I'm going to teach you, that will make it easier to do the comparisons. And two, it depends on how the arrays are different. Imagine that the exact same sequence is represented on two arrays. And the only difference that you'll see are differences that are caused by the way the arrays are constructed or the way in which they hybridize. So technological improvements, but the sequence characteristics are the same. Alternatively, they may decide that we should actually be designing the arrays to a different part of the gene, and now you'll have sequence-based differences, which can cause differences in cross-hybridization, noise, etc., and now you've got really big problems. So if it's the exact same sequence, it's not terribly difficult. If it's different sequences, it's painful. 133A and A2.0 and plus 2.0 share a common core of sequences that are present for everything. There are differences between the B and the plus 2 and the B and the A. And my recommendation to people almost always is to not try to do a global pooled analysis of different microarrays. It's very difficult. There's lots of literature on people describing ways that get it to work, and then they don't really get it to work in a general way. It's data set one to derive a conclusion and try to validate it in data set two. And set one and two if they're on different microarray platforms. And even if they're on the same platform, there are real challenges with trying to get data generated at Harvard and Toronto merged together because of differences in the production facility, so batch differences. So in general, I suggest you treat each experiment as a separate experiment and just determine if the conclusions are concordant. This is a good question. I would probably be one of those reviewers who has that as a generic comment that I give a lot. So one thing is that CCGA has changed so that the majority of its data is not generated by RPC graphics. Just that's one general comment. Number two, imagine that your difference that you detect biologically sufficiently large that it can be detected even given the change in platforms and technology. That should give you some additional confidence that it's real. And so that would be one of the arguments for how you should be able to validate or consider that. That being said, gene level conclusions are often validatable across platforms. So for example, P53 is overexpressed in a wide variety of lung basically because its degradation is messed up and that leads to accumulation. And that's something that you can see by RNA arrays in any platform, any type, and that sort of thing. And if you do a focused gene-wise analysis that's been done with quality, and that you kind of go back to the raw TCGA data and process it in a way that's consistent with what you're doing, you'll usually find consistent results across platforms. Can't merge the data into a single statistical model and use it to go from one to now have five. But you should be able to kind of take GY specific conclusions and show generalizability that way. Well, search question is different, but search question is different, yeah. Absolutely. And so, one comment, just generically, if somebody asked me to use a data set, the data set had only 35 patients that were first thing I would do is not analyze data. I would do a power analysis and go back to it and say, yeah, so we have a 0.03% chance of detecting the difference in this data set. That shows that you've actually thought about the question because you're out of trouble 90% of the time. As for the challenges of analyzing TCGA and bioinformatics, that's absolutely true. I mean, my team's strategy is not even to use the TCGA results, pull down the raw data, we analyze it from scratch using our own methods and methods that are in the literature and so forth. And I think it's a while, it will be a while before people are confident in a singular way of analyzing that data that can be universally applied all the time. I'll give one story about TCGA. Sorry. So we've had a discussion about TCGA without saying exactly what it is. So TCGA, very broadly, the Cancer Genome Atlas. It's a U.S. NIH-funded study to analyze 500 tumors of 25 different tumor types using DNA sequencing, RNA sequencing, and methylation analysis with some of it. So it's intended to atlas of the different mutations within each of these 25 tumor types. And so TCGA is publishing, is kind of in its publishing phase now. There may be 5 or 6 papers that are published with 5 or so in press and another 5 that are coming. So you would have seen last summer, TCGA Nature papers about lung squamous cell carcinoma, breast cancer, kidney cancer, and colorectal cancer. In the summer, there were gastric, head and neck, a bunch of others, and a few other things. So it's a very large data set, one of the largest standardized genomics projects in the world, actually much bigger than 1,000 genomes or CatMap or anything like that. Right. The other thing I'll say is TCGA data, if you're working with it, is interesting because the goal of the project is to provide an atlas, not to provide an answer to every question people might have. Just to give you one simple way in which they do things that I wouldn't, they find the top and bottom 10% of every gene. So if you have 500 patients, the 50 patients with the lowest and the 50 patients with the highest levels of that gene are called to have overexpression and underexpression. That doesn't mean that they necessarily do. It doesn't mean that the population is trimodal. It doesn't mean that there's even any variability at all. But it's just a uniform definition of bottom 10%, top 10%, and those in the middle. The effect of that is they're assuming 20% of all people are outliers for every single gene. It's probably not a good assumption. There are genes where it's much larger and genes that it's much smaller. But to kind of standardize things across a big project, they did that. Depending on which level you download the data, you might be dealing with stuff that has no real validity. And so there's one story that's applicable to everybody. If you download a public data set, I strongly recommend analyze that data set using your own experimental protocols, your own analysis, exactly as you would if it was something that you had generated yourself. Don't treat it as if, oh, that group did it, it must be right. Even if it's my group. You know, we think we do it right, that's great. But that doesn't mean it's right for what you want to do with the data set. And that's one thing that we'll get over the course of the session, is that different analyses provide different results. I use different methods to answer different questions. So, any other questions? So let's talk about algorithms and then kind of see how that sheds some light on what we've been talking about. So,
sequential series of computational start off with a you apply an algorithm. I want you to remember that a paper their effect over them.
when it finally was. Divided into two.
I think I see a grid over here. I think I see another grid over there. And it's easy for you. Thank you.
challenge is probably the ultimate. Essence in life. Thank you.
impact back on the program of a result in the metrics.
Thank you.
that are not even being investigated. Gene expression on this express. Multi-channel array.
can control. The noise is plus or minus. Data was
A lot of people, future of the development. What is highly expected that circles can be multi-dimensional spheres, so these can be sort of multi-dimensional spheres. Distance across the cluster is similar. Every time that minus the distance, that may be the size. I have to say.
Something upon which many people are working and publishing new development on a kind of basis. Let's talk a little bit about specific optometrics data, and then we'll start with optometrics specific workflow here, and show some of the details about the technology in a little more detail after lunch. So basically, this is the optometrics, this is the generic optometrics data. A couple of things are different. First, all the optometrics defaults for quantitation. Usually, there are exceptions to that. One channel array. Everybody else does spot one. The single channel array is a simultaneous correlation. Last side and rephrase it a little bit. Basically, an affymetrics work. Start off with the CPL file, the quantitative information. Annotate genes, perform statistics, clustering, and integration. Post-set annotation means that you have a way to change or reference genome itself changes. So we used to think that we were representing the most common sequence of something, but instead we found out, no, this was a unique variant that was very boutique, private. The person whom we sequence the reference genome, and therefore we need to adjust it or for things like splice variants or error.
talked about the math metrics arrays expensive to change. So we take advantage of the fact that there are multiple probes per gene, and multiple probes per gene are related to the genes in the chip definition file. We go ahead and adjust that. So essentially, what we're trying to do is affect the math metrics. All the ways in which a source of noise can arise, the construction of the array, the hybridization, or the method of both sample propagation itself. So we're going to start off, I think, at this point, working in on the data. We'll pick up here after we've kind of gotten the data loaded in the afternoon and discuss what we're starting to do.